Well, gentlemen, those are our proposals.
Do I understand that these plans involve the destruction of several historic buildings that bring a lot of money into this town?
If I can answer that briefly, Mr. Chairman, yes. There'll be a certain inevitable loss. But more to the point, I could fill 10 of those 12 floors tomorrow.
There could be a real problem, Mr. Adler, with the loss of light at the spa end. You might have to lose the top floors of your office block. However, I think you will find that if you were to alter the angle of this building, the problem might be solved. Exactly.
I'm sorry, but that doesn't answer my question. What guarantees have we got
all
that
right,
they...
I'll talk straight. We've got developments all over the country. I know what councils are up against. Land prices rising all the time, cost of buildings going up. You can't expect people to vote for you if you're asking them for money all the time. Well, I've got the finance. I've got the architects. I can do justice to your town, and it won't cost you a penny.
Gentlemen, I think Mr. Adler's been very frank. In my view, the scheme will only enhance the trading and commercial life of the town. I also think it fair to say that in view of the overall condition of many of the existing properties, the area will have to come up for development in the next few years anyway. As I see it, the choice before the council is this. Either we refuse planning permission, in which case we shall ourselves have to consider an alternative scheme for the area in the very near future, with all the resultant costs, or we go ahead in the way that Mr. Adler outlines. Certainly, I'm raising no objection to the architect's plan.
Right. Let's not piss about. Get that side cleared. I want him out. Okay, let's get moving.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed a very special privilege and pleasure for me tonight to propose the toast to our distinguished guest. David, I'm sure he won't mind me calling him David, is really one of Snellgrove's own. He was brought up here, he went to school here, and from here he went on to greater things. Unfortunately, we don't see very much of him these days because he's far too busy being successful in London. But we're all proud and honored to have him with us tonight. and hope that this won't be the last time that we will enjoy his charming and, if I might say so, witty company. I'll remind David what a wonderful little town this is, what a prosperous little community, and what a fine place to invest in.
The toast is, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. David Adler.
How do you do? Ted Harden. This is my wife, Diane.
You dance very well. I'd like the next one.
Dance in places like this.
It's all in the line of business. Do you ever talk to London?
For you, I would.
One, two, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock.
10, 11
o'clock, 12 o'clock,
we're
gonna rock around the clock tonight.
Put your glad rags on. Thank you. Pleasure. I hope we meet again.
Anytime you're in London.
Yeah.
Hello, George. How are you?
Who is that?
It's David. I'd like to see you.
I'm rather busy just now.
Look, I'll give you lunch. You probably need a decent meal, and I need to talk to you.
Well, I can't answer the Imperial call just like that.
I haven't seen you for 2 years. Get a taxi and come over. I'll pay for it.
All right. I'll come over right away.
Can I help you, sir?
I have an appointment with Mr. Adler.
I'll tell him you're here, sir. What name shall I give?
George Timmins.
Comfortable. Still on the dole?
Yeah.
You're a terrible punt. That's 5 years, isn't it?
About that.
Why don't you get yourself a job?
I leave the rat race to you.
Don't nick all the cigars.
I never touched them.
Get yourself a drink.
Well, what is it this time?
That's a very churlish thing to say, George.
In the last 15 years, you've called me 5 times. And I've come 5 times.
We're very good friends, George. I value that.
I bet.
30 years is 30 years. George, I've got trouble. It's nice, but it's trouble.
Rich, young, powerful, and he still has problems.
It's a girl. A woman, really.
Isn't it always?
I'm mad about her. I can't get enough of her. I want to screw her every minute of the day.
So what's the problem?
Well, she's ugly.
How do you mean ugly?
Well, she's from Snellgrove.
What were you doing in Snellgrove?
Well, I went back there to a Chamber of Commerce meeting for some local PR. She was there. I sort of invited her, if ever she was in London. 2 weeks later, the phone rings. It's her. I mean, it's ridiculous. She's got white boots and a blue Angora dress, cologne. It was like going back 20 years. She says, I'm here. So I said, I can't think of anything to say. And I couldn't, except I want you. So she laughs and puts her arms around my neck, and I had her right here on the sofa, with her white boots and a blue Angora dress around her bum. And it was terrible. Can you remember what it was like at 16? Can you remember your eagerness? Well, it was so easy. And afterwards she says, I knew it'd be like that. And she started to cry. I've been seeing her every Thursday for the last 2 months. She was in primary school, lower down. Diane White?
Well, that's very moving.
I'm very happy for you. And I have to say at this point, nothing like that has happened to me in the last 5 years.
Well, it's bother.
Bother?
She's a suburban housewife.
Oh, you mean you're bored?
No, well... not exactly.
David, it's been a pleasure to see you, Squire. Makes a change from Paddington. Curiously enough, I do have things to do, so if you need to phone me again in the next 3 years, you know.
I want you to meet her. She's coming here and, well, it's a bit of a weird scene for me. Look, Diane's been complaining that I never take her anywhere and I don't introduce her to my friends. And I told her that I introduce her to you.
Why me?
For Christ's sake, who else can I introduce her to?
Thank you.
George, I want you to do me a favor. That's all. I need your help.
What else?
She's a small town girl. It'll give her a buzz to talk to you. Tell her you're a writer. Make her feel she's with the big time. Oh, come on, George. It's no skin off your nose, just for half an hour.
Why should I?
Come on, go into my bedroom and put some clothes on and look the part. Come on, hurry it up.
Sorry, I didn't know anyone else was here.
It's all right, it's only George.
Hello, George. I've heard a lot about you. It's funny to think of us all coming from Snellgrove. Have you been back at all?
No.
Oh, it's still the same. Though I expect you'd find it a bit boring now.
Why?
Oh, you know. Where do you used to live?
Wells Road. Right next door to David.
Oh. You know Alton Andrews School? They've pulled it down now.
Have they? Were you there when Miss Thatcher was there?
Oh, yes. The one whose feet used to bulge over her shoe straps. I do remember her giving me the ruler once.
Yes, I remember she caned David once.
That's right, she did. You dropped me in it.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did. You nicked those castanets out of the percussion band cupboard and hid them in my desk.
You were amply compensated. You had my sandwiches for the rest of the term.
Sugar sandwiches?
Well, it was wartime, wasn't it? Your mother never used to make you any anyway.
She always knew what a good friend you were.
I think it's really super you two have stayed friends all these years. David says you write films.
In between books.
Must be wonderful being in films. You must know all the people. What are they really like?
They're just like everybody else, really.
Oh, come on. You probably think I'm silly, but I'd love to know all the gossip.
It's just like you read in the papers. It's not very different from David's life, actually. Fast cars, penthouse flats, and beautiful women. I prefer Rome to Hollywood myself. London's very dull just now. Days of the great parties have gone. Michael Caine, David Bailey, Christine Keeley, the Beatles, the Stones. Sometimes they used to go on for 3 or 4 days, you know. By the end of it, everybody had had everybody else. And some people were coming out for the second time round. I remember this starlet. She said to me, she looked me straight in the eyes, and she said, I've had everybody here except Steve McQueen. And I said, you'll have to have him long distance because he's in Hollywood.
I don't believe you're kidding me.
It's all gospel, isn't it, David?
If George says so.
Well, I better be going now.
Oh, must you?
Have to meet a producer coming in from Honolulu.
I'll see you again.
I'll arrange something.
That'd be nice.
You're gonna be late.
Fine.
Thanks for coming over.
Thanks for the lunch.
Any margin money, George? What's the score? What are you so nervous about?
I'm not nervous.
stick that in my cake, will you? I'm going to enjoy this little party. Those Burks were at school with, they're going to be there.
What about the husband?
What about him?
What do you see in
him? Thought you were going to tell me that. Hang on, George. My name's David Adler. Is the host Ted Harden about?
Host?
Yeah.
Glad you could make it, old boy. Hope it wasn't too hard to find. Come on. Well, how about a drink? How special.
Yes, something suddenly comes to.
This they say now seems really the spot to go to.
Just for the moment, we're not on speaking yet. Oh, thank you, darling.
I've already had fun.
Settle down, boys. Settle down. Come on, come on. Adler. Come on, pick of the pot.
Oh, all right.
Come on.
I want one of those kissing her now.
It's a girl. A woman, really.
Isn't it always?
Yeah, I'm mad about her. I can't get enough of her. I want to screw her every minute of the day.
So what's the problem?
Morning. Sleep well? Good. Ah, thank you. It's just that I don't like to see the place looking like a pigsty. How about some breakfast? I'll rustle up something in the kitchen. Read the papers if you like. Or if you fancy a bath or anything, upstairs on the left. No sense in waking Diane yet, eh?
September the 3rd. I can't stand autumn. It's like...
George! Breakfast!
You don't mind eating in the kitchen, do you? We always eat here when it's casual.
Not at all.
Well, the Sambos live, isn't it?
Sambos?
Just my expression for our coloured brethren. No. Don't get up to London much. Business keeps me too busy down here. Touch wood.
What do you do?
Groceries. Old family concern. Of course, I've expanded a bit since then. Small self-service supermarket type of thing, you know.
Is trade good?
Very nice. Mustn't grumble, you know. Still, wouldn't interest you, probably. It's what you're used to, I suppose. I always say the two best trades are food and undertaking. Everybody's got to eat, and they've all got to die. Yes. A lot of people sniff their noses at trade. But we don't hold the country to ransom with strikes and things. Morning, love. Well, duty calls.
Last night. I think I've ruined everything.
You want to talk about it?
The party, everything. I didn't mean anything by it. I just wanted to see him again. Tell him I'm sorry. Please make it right with me again. Please. September the 3rd. I can't stand autumn. It's like a funeral. All the dead leaves depress me. So I went to the pictures to cheer myself up. It wasn't very good. This evening, Ted went to one of his functions, so I was on my own for a change. Watched telly and had a bath. Paddy came. 2 days early. I thought it was due on Wednesday. September the 10th. I can't believe it. He's really gorgeous. Those eyelashes and that voice. He's like a dream come true. And when he said he wanted to see me in London, I went all weak at the knees. He couldn't be serious. But he did leave his card, and I knew that was his way of letting me have his address. And he definitely was interested. I could feel that all right. It's silly to build up hopes because you can always be let down. But he did say phone. My stomach's churning just at the thought. I at least won't be able to close my eyes all week. I feel marvellous. November the 4th. Met David's friend George, who was really nice and successful. But I can never understand with people like that how careless they are about certain things in their appearance. I mean, he's quite good looking, but it was a bit of a shock to find when I looked that his hair was running alive with dandruff. You'd think someone in his position could use a medicated shampoo.
If I want a gangbang with a bunch of semi-retarded shopkeepers, I'll ask for it. She wants to screw her old man's best friend every Friday night and giggle about it next day at the golf club, okay. But don't let her try and involve me in it.
Well, she only wanted to see you. It was a mistake.
Anyway, what are you getting so Puritan about in your old age? David? David? David!
Bang, you're dead. Your reactions always were slower.
Look, she's very upset. Why don't you give her a ring?
What's it to you?
No! David!
In any case, I phoned her. George, I got plans for this hick town.
Well, how's that for timing? Welcome to Ireland. Glad you came. What's Ted doing for Christmas?
He's playing golf.
He doesn't mind?
Look at that.
That's nothing. Wait till we get further west. You know, sometimes I feel this whole place belongs to me personally.
Sure the Almighty didn't subcontract you when you made it?
What?
Thank you.
George, you're in the boathouse.
To the boats?
Take a look for yourself. Comfortable? Come and have a look at the house.
How long have you had it?
Well, 5 or 6 years. It was an old room when I got it. No, I come here when I want to be on my own. Would you like to have a drink?
Can I see the rest first?
Sure, come on. What's the matter?
It's just so...
Pity there isn't a tree.
What do you think of Anthony Powell, George?
Evelyn War gone cold.
You always were a superior literate bastard.
Not at all.
You know, George got a first at Oxford.
Pardon?
I got a scholarship to go to Cambridge. I went to Australia instead. I thought, who needs it?
Finished up with a diploma in business studies at the University of Canberra.
It was a degree. Then I went on to sell used cars in Sydney and made a few grand.
Down under.
And when I got back to England, here was George, flushed with first-class honours. And I said, what do you want to do?
I want to do a thesis. Teach. Something inoffensive.
And I said, that's all balls. I'm going into property. I want lots of money, fast car, plenty of clothes, flat, as many women as I can screw. You should have seen his face.
I suppose we can say you remain true to your ideals.
Yeah. Well, I guess it's time for me to play Santa Claus.
Presents, you mean?
Mm-hmm.
presence is exactly what I mean. Well, Merry Christmas, George.
Christ, thanks.
Open it.
Thanks very much.
That's all right. You'll be able to impress your friends down in Paddington. And now for you, my lovely. First, this.
Oh, it's lovely. It's the most lovely present I've ever had.
Well, let's see it on, for Christ's sake.
Would you help me with it?
George will do it for you.
How does it look? I want to see how I look. You don't think my neck looks too thick? What's this?
It's another present for you. It's not a bomb, open it. Let's see them.
Silly, I'm embarrassed.
Let's see them. Don't you like them?
When would I wear them?
Well, what about right now?
Don't be silly.
I'm not being silly. I'd like to see you in them. I'm sure George would, too. Go and put them on.
No.
I bought them. And I want to see you in them. Go and put them on. That sort of thing turn you on, George?
I don't know. It's not the kind of thing I go in for.
You ought to try it sometime. You don't know what you're missing out on.
Look, why Diane?
George, you're so bloody naive.
He's gone.
Where?
Back to London.
Well, that's friendly. How do we get home?
Oh, he's arranged for a local driver to take us to the airport tomorrow.
So we're stuck here. Why did he go?
He got moody and depressed. He wanted to go.
Well, we could have shared his mood. Well, we could have shared his car and gone with him.
He wanted to be on his own. I bought some scotch. Do you want a drink?
Oh, why not? Merry Christmas. Diane, what the hell's going to happen between you two?
It's up to him, I think.
What about you? You're part of it. What do you want?
I want him.
Suppose he doesn't really want you.
Then I'll be very miserable. But he does want me.
Yeah. And what does he want you for? What about earlier?
Well, that proves that he wants me, doesn't it?
I thought I was pretty brutish and insensitive myself. I know that I could never do
it. But you're not a bit like him. It's just his way. You don't really like him, do you?
Sometimes I think he's a bastard, yes.
And that's because you're not a woman.
You mean you're prepared to put up with it?
You are funny, George. You really are.
What do you mean?
You just are. You're not really a film writer, are you? I asked our local projectionist. He's never heard of you. And he knows every film since they were silent.
No, I'm not a film writer.
Did he ask you to pretend for me?
That's right.
Well, that proves that he wants me.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
You're not jealous of me, are you? Only friends sometimes are.
Van, David and I aren't particularly friends. We just grew up together, that's all. Over the years, he's called me over to signify some change in his material progress. A new car, more expensive suite of offices, more opulent flat, an even trendier bird. And I've gone over and nodded my approval and faded away. I was a university lecturer. Till I couldn't stand it anymore. Oxford. My lady wife. My two odious children. So I left. For the last 5 years, I've been living on Librium and the Dole. So you see, David and I have nothing in common at all.
Why do you keep on seeing him then?
Let's say he commands my presence. Anyway, it's tough living on the Dole.
You are sweet, George. And a bit cunning, too.
I think I ought to go to bed now. I'm tired anyway.
Frightened to sleep in that house on my own. I'm not used to it. Could I sleep here? Just as friends. I always wanted to be a dancer, but I ended up in a typing pool. Till I met Ted, that was it. Good night, George. You're really nice.
Can I help you?
Yes, I'd like to speak to Mr. David Adler, please.
Have you an appointment?
No, I haven't.
Mr. Adler never sees anyone without an appointment.
Yes, well, he did say to call by when I was in London.
Well, I'll try. What was the name?
Harden. Mr. Ted Harden.
What's the estimated losses? What's tucked away in assets? Christ, that's bits and pieces. 30 acres. How many acres? Right. That sounds interesting. Yeah, in the outskirts. Look, you'd better get yourself back to London, Murray. I can't do business on phones. Get me a cup of tea, would you, Olive Love?
There's a Mr. Hardin wants to see you.
Who?
Ted Hardin.
Christ. What does he want? Okay, let him in.
Mr. Hardin?
Yes?
Press the door when the buzzer goes and come along.
Right, fine, thank you.
Nice to see you. Make yourself comfortable.
Sorry about barging in like this, but...
What can I do for you?
Well, I need some help. Some professional advice. I thought a man with your experience might...
Sit down.
Thank you. To be frank, I feel a bit out of my depth. Diane suggested I should come and see you.
What's the matter?
It's my shop, the business. They want me out. Some property dealer or other wants the lease to pull it down. Been in the family business for 40-odd years. I want to fight them, and I don't mind spending any amount of money. I thought perhaps you might be able to help. Good lawyer. Something. Now that's it, really.
You serious, Ted?
Very.
There must be some misunderstanding. I mean, it's my company.
I don't understand.
I'm developing the site.
I really came to the wrong place, didn't I?
No, you came to the right place. Let's kick it around. What's the problem? I thought we made you a fair offer.
I'm not going to sell.
We carried out a big survey on those shops. I know the condition, the turnover, and the future of every one of them. They're gonna fall down by themselves within 5 years. I'm doing you a favor.
Look, it's my living. It's something that I've built. So don't you try and tell me that you're doing me a favor.
I'm doing the whole town a favor. Progress requires change. You can't stand in the way of that. Look, I can offer you first option on a lease when the complex is completed.
You just don't understand, do you? To you, it's just another investment. It's my life. I put everything I had into this. You can't buy that. That shop's mine.
Not a chance, Ted. There's too much cash invested here. Why don't you get smart? Take the money and run.
I'll tell you something. You can go to hell.
Mm-hmm. It's still a good offer.
There's nothing more to discuss.
What do I bastard pay you money for? Why do I have to have all the aggravation? I want the planning officer. I want an invitation sent to him for dinner. You understand? I want him to have the full treatment. Send one of the rollers along to pick him up. I can't stand halfway mugs.
Oh, you've certainly got a wonderful flat. No, no more, thank you.
Do you like your job, Alec?
Well, public service isn't everybody's cup of tea. I've enjoyed it, I suppose. I've been at it for 25 years. Retiring next year.
Salary's not exactly enormous, is it?
It's sufficient.
The last thing I'd call money is sufficient. You can always do with a bit more.
I suppose that's true.
We're having problems with a guy called Ted Harden. He won't give up his lease. As a council, you have rights to compulsory purchase.
Our own schemes, yes.
But you're endorsing this one?
Not the same thing.
Why isn't it?
Because we aren't financing it.
But I'm saving you the burden of it.
Well, I suppose you could say that.
I am.
I can only raise it with the committee.
But you are the committee. You're the man.
All decisions are democratic.
That's shit, and you know it. Everyone wants to see this scheme go through. There's one idiotic man standing in the way. And you can get him out of the way.
I can only raise it with the committee.
It's a gift. A gesture of my gratitude. Who's to know? I'm not going to tell anyone. You can have it in Deutschmarks, Japanese yen, and a Swiss account, any way you want it. Tax-free. Don't be a mug, Alec. There's nothing illegal in a gift. Do your wife a favor. You've worked hard all your life. For what? Don't be unkind to yourself, Alec. Great, you're early. I've got a surprise for you. Wheel of cider in. I've moved her in. Well, you surprised?
I suppose so.
Yes.
Not as surprised as I was.
We're going out to celebrate. What do you think?
Fine.
What are you looking so miserable about? Did you get a job?
I spent nearly all afternoon at the beauty salon. What do you think?
Terrific.
Well, you have to get used to it because this is the way I aim to be. Oh, does that sound big-headed?
I like you the way you were, that's all. I suppose I like you the way you want to be.
Oh, you are sweet, George. Come here and I give you a little kissy.
Turn it up, I'm hungry.
Seven on those dice now, and it's a six. Came the halfway on six now, 6.6 the money. Here we go on six now.
And six.
Yeah, they fly them over by the jumbo load.
It's very exciting, though.
You want to play?
In a minute, when I get my bearings.
And that's a nine on them dice now, 6.6 the money. Here we go for six now. Six now.
Peter, can we have two vodka sours and a lager?
Hello, Dave.
Hello, Ron.
Nice to see you.
I don't think you know Diane and George.
Pleased to meet you. We've just had a lovely cruise down to Canaries. Very nice. I took the old woman and kids. Plenty of cheap booze. Nice and relaxing. No aggravation. Rely on everything you know. Good food. Band in the evening.
Rock about a bit.
Well, I was a bit worried at first about being seasick. Knowing how dodgy my stomach is. But no trouble at all, Dave. Just like glass it was. Really nice. Well, nice to see you, my son. Look after yourself. Glad to know you.
Who was that?
I guess you'd call him a gangster.
Dear Ted, you know how hopeless I am at writing things down, but I hope you'll forgive me because I can't say this to your face. I'll always remember you as a kind and considerate man who has worked hard to give me what I needed. But you know by now what I am like, what a dreamer I am, and also what I feel for David. I can't go on living two lives. And now that he wants me to live with him, I must go. I don't really know what else to say except that I hope you will not be too sad. With love, Diane.
George, I'm going to be busy. You do me a favor and take her out, keep her happy. She likes you. I'll put you on the payroll with expenses. 100 a week. Can't be fairer than that. What do you say?
It's a deal.
You can have anything you want in the whole world. Name it, and it's yours.
The operation. Well, how does it look?
Terrific.
You know what's the matter with you, George? You're a mug. I like you, but you're a mug. You know what I stand to make out of this deal today? $1,000,000. That's real magic. Not like those fairy godmothers' wands they used to wave at the panto. There's nothing you can't turn it into. There's nothing it won't do.
Don't be unkind to Georgie Porgy. He's my best friend. Aren't you, Georgie?
That's right, Ben. That's
right. What? Who's smarter? Who's cleverer? And who's shrewder? Where are you going?
I'm going home.
You're staying here. It's a celebration.
I have a question. Is money the real mind of all things?
Don't be so profound, George. But if you really want to know, yes.
I'm tired. I want to sleep.
You can stay here. You can sleep in the guest room.
I'm going home.
You're staying here. Take Diane to the races tomorrow.
Bedtime, George.
What you need is a good woman. I'll fix you up with one. Tomorrow.
Thank you.
Ted's in Broughton. At the news of the murder, shares in Adler Securities fell several points. They picked up when it was announced that business would continue. The Sunday Times paid £12,500 for the Adler story. In Snellgrove, a 12-story building now dominates the new city development. It is as yet unoccupied and stands there, the sun glinting on its 1,000 windows, emptily and profitably waiting for rent values to rise.
Thank you.